for the afterwards program. This is hosted in conjunction with the National Library Board of Singapore and Ethos Books. Today I have great pleasure in introducing arguably Singapore's eco poet. Right?
Who's arguing?
Well, there are some people who say, no, I write about nature too.
Yeah,
I write about nature. Yeah, that's right. That's one that I'm sitting there. Yeah. Madeleine Lee, she is an investment banker by day and a poet by day and night. because she has six collections of poetry to her name, and she has also...
She can only get it right day and night.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, and she looks at things, anything in the environment around her, and she thinks that that's fodder for writing. You know? And I have actually been a long-time admirer of her work. Secret admirer, I think. And she only realized it recently when I said, when your single head lamp came out, I took a look at it, I said, wow, I said, this is not, you know, and she said, whoa. Yeah, that was many years back when the first collection came out. Yeah. But anyway, she's here today to explain to her, the latest thinking and writing about her newest book, 1.618. Yeah, so, and of course, after that, she will also talk about other collections if you're, So, without any more ado, I'll just let her start. Right, Madeleine?
Yes. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Alright.
I will talk and then I will get out and I'll sit down and I'll move around. So, anyways, hot morning. I know, I want to thank you for, being here Friday. If you can't hear me, just make funny gestures, small voice. You're here on Friday evening and it's really bad, so thank you for being here. But I know that there's three times the crowd that it should have been. Because originally this flyer said, you all saw this, right? That's why you're here. This flyer originally said, join us for an interesting talk. Then people sent to me and said, check whether your this blah 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 is correct. So very small, so I cannot see. After I check out my time glass, I check all okay. Then I said, it doesn't sound so interesting as you said. Join us for interesting talk, then nobody will come up. So then I said, okay, I'll leave it to you. And he said, I'll do something. And now it says, provocative, unique, and exhilarating. Find one which you put in a small box and then after a while, your small box will have enough, say about another 30 poems, that means you have to write 30 poems to get one, so you have to write 930 poems, and you show to a possible publisher who will say, ah, go away. So that's what I do, I write and I write and I write and I write day and night and whatever. And I tell myself to write one poem a week. I'm just warming up because it's boring, trust me. And I try to write 50 a year, which is one a week with 2 weeks leave. But of course, it doesn't really happen like this. But what it does for me is because I have a proper day job and it's really unliterary. By the time it gets to say middle of the year, 30th June, and I look at my year's writing, and I don't have 25, 24, I will know that my life balance is completely shot. Okay, so obviously I have too few, and then I would remind myself that I spent the last 4 months doing what, basically going to work and back, getting tired. So then I do one of the following things. I go for very, very long walks. I go for walks in China Gardens, which is sort of civilized. I go for walks at MacRitchie, which can be a 10-kilometer walk from MacRitchie all the way to Bukit Timah, or it can be 1 hour because I'm busy and I do 5 kilometers, 4 kilometers quickly, or come on, not 4 kilometers, 2 kilometers. I can walk on the boardwalk, which is nice and civilized, except it's very dangerous because now people want to jog on it too. But mostly I stray off into the rainforest trail, which is just rubble and so on, and I just walk. And I walk alone, I don't know my friends, I don't talk to people. But actually people talk a lot when they walk.
Yeah.
Do you realize it? Like, suddenly you realize there's somebody in front of you because they're talking 2 miles ahead of you. Anyway, but it's okay, it's a companionship and it's nice. But I walk alone and I walk, I don't jog, I walk because it's at that pace that I see things. I see things. I see things in leaves. I see things in earthworms. I see things in fungus. And then I try to make sense and take meaning out of them. Sometimes nothing happens. I'm sorry. And the other thing that I do is I write. So coming back to writing 50 a year, there's a point to this story. Coming back to writing 50 a year and realizing in the middle of, so right now is end of August, right? So how many should I have? 2/3 of the year. 32, 33. I can tell you I don't have, I only have 40. 2003, I label my poetry 13/something. So 01. I'm only at 13/14. I looked before I came. And then what happens is when I go on trips, they come in big batches with the observations and the writing. So I observe things, I either jot them down or I keep them in my head and then I write. And it comes in sketches. So if you go on holiday, you can just write one piece. I don't know. And it just comes in a big lump. So that's how I quickly at the end of the year make up my own quota. You go to 52 or 50. Why do you say that? I'll tell you the story because this book is the result of a trip that I made with my son to Serengeti in Tanzania, and we went there to see the wildebeest migration. Son was 9 years old, and it was can ask questions and I love my dog. He's like, that's not the answer. Does anybody know? I just want to help the rest of the class.
Never went to Australia before.
So it's in Tanzania, and the wildebeest, they basically migrate, and they migrate in hundreds of thousands, sometimes a million of them. And they move from the south, and they go all the way up to the north part of the Serengeti, which then suddenly becomes Kenya. And then they come back down, and they cross the river, the Maasai River. And then they come down back to the south. And then they go again, and then and it takes 1 year for them to do that, and then they never rest. And then what they do is they're actually following the rain, because the rain is very, very dry. It's almost semi-desert already. The rain falls, and it causes, because it's so dry, the minute the rain comes, the grass will grow. And that is, they need feet, so they follow the rain and the grass. And by the time they reach, they will birth in the southwest. And they'll give birth to their calves. And then they will all go north and then cross this river, and half of the young wildebeest get eaten by the crocodiles. And the rest are left, they go to the Maasai, which is very green. They eat and they come down again. By the time they reach the bottom, they are ready to give birth, and then they do it all over again. They do it the whole time and they never stop. On the way, they get eaten, they get, you know, lots of hunted, lots of things. And it's because my son is like a Nat Geo kind of fan. So, and as I am. And then it fascinated me that you know, this animal just doesn't stop, it keeps going, and it just is programmed to keep going for various reasons. And they know their young will be eaten, and you know, I mean, they know, I mean, I guess they know, they've seen, and some of them don't know, and it doesn't stop. So then, out of that, I wrote a series of poems, and there were sort of like 13 of them. About the Serengeti and the migration. Some of them were animals, some of them were the landscape, and some of them were the people I met, the 13th. And at the end of the poem was a kind of a subplot, if you would, of the migration of African egret. So there's the big the bees going to the, and then there's the bird, because we also went to a lake that is an inland lake, so it's got no rivers flowing, it's like the Dead Sea. But anyway, on the shore, lots of bird life, and we were told about the African egret. And then of course the egret also migrate the whole time, depending on the weather. And then it occurred to me that the African egret has a parallel with the egret that I've been seeing here. This is like very convoluted already. And I went to look up my old poetry, and then I found a whole series on the Asian egret, which flies here on the way to, flies here from somewhere in North India, in the Middle East, and not Middle East, near the India, above India, what's that? And on the way, it lands here, stops for a while, and goes off to Australia, and then does the whole thing and comes back. And then it's because of the weather. Then I realized that I've been seeing these egrets come to Singapore, and they land here. It's around November, December. They are in Sungai Buloh. They are in the canals of Bukit Timah. They are not only at the west, they are in the north, northwest. And I've been observing them for 9 or 10 years. So every year, they have a regret or in the drain or something. And so I had a little one big African migration, little bird migration, and that little bird migration falls into the same pattern as the bird migration that's happening and involving us here. I'm trying to make some literary sense of it. So anyway, so I saw this whole series as one big circle, and that wouldn't stop. Because of migration, because I went to Africa, then I came home, and the birds are here, then I go traveling, then I come home. And it's about a journey that sort of doesn't end. It's not about going out and coming back, because soon you have to go back out and see things. And where is home? You know, so on an abstract level, then there was a question of these things go, where is home? I don't really know if the birds have such a concept. It's wherever they need to be at one time. So then I put this collection and I showed various publishers, and they went, okay, great. And I said, this book cannot start and end at different points, it has to start and end at the same point. And I went, go away! So it took 2 years, and even Kuo Ho Fang and I had to think so hard about it. Like the screaming out was another publisher. But no. So, just kidding. So it was quite important to me that the book physically conveyed the message. So first I thought of, when you were small, when I was small, ages ago, you go to Chinatown and New Year, then you buy this paper pineapples. Which is folded and got two sticks and even tea. And then it becomes a and then also lanterns, right? Then I thought, okay, I can have a book that folds like this, and then it will not finish, and then when you finish it, forget, and then keep it in pocket. And then people told me, like, scale away. And finally we talked to this designer, Winnie, who really ought to be here, because the concept is carrying the book very much, not so much the other way around. And she came up with this concept of the no start, no end, it's infinity. And I know you haven't touched the book, but this is the book. This is what it looks like when it is undone. Yeah? I'm going to use mine because I'm sometimes in danger of tearing it apart. So the book. I want to be my banner white. The book doesn't open traditionally. The book opens this way, and you will have, after the first two pages of drama, you will have a math formula, which I will explain. And then you will have instructions on how to read this book. So you follow the black line, and when you reach here, you turn this way, and you turn the book here, and you start reading. So you can read on a bus, you don't have to open like this. And then we'll keep going. And when you reach the back, it tells you to come all the way back, and then it ends here at the back. So it, then when you turn the book around, it starts all over again. So I would just say the designer is totally brilliant. And she made whatever I had in my head become real. And Ho Fang thought this together. I just wrote the words. But having said that, so actually when you reach the end of the first set, you will turn everything on. If your reading is on the floor, you start looking at it. And you can see that there's a loop going back in. And then later at the back, you flip everything over and you come back out at this side. Read all the way out and reach cover again. So, I mean, I know it's
complicated.
I mean, it's not so much the poetry right now, but it's the whole concept. And I'm very delighted to say that this really, really helped me articulate the concept properly. Shall I stop for a little while?
Do you have to read?
So the first part of the book is about serenity and the African safari. The second part is more about
what happened in the middle is that African egret met the Asian egret. I mean, really, they met in a two-part poem at the bottom of the collection and joined the thing together for me. And then the egret series actually worked backwards in time and then comes back home to my earliest egret poem, or second earliest, because earliest is another book. And I'll read you some. Should I explain the title right now?
Yes.
So, the Metz formula is here, but when I put the collections together, it wasn't intentional, but when I noticed there was an egret follow through, and I took out my work, then I realized at one morning at 3 a.m. or 4 a.m. in the morning that they fell into a Fibonacci series number. Fibonacci series. Who wants to tell me what it is? This young lady will tell me.
No,
she's
stretching
for me.
So
if you're a
kid,
tell us what is a Fibonacci.
No! I have no idea what that is!
There's a mathematical concept because my other brain is like this. Where this man, Fibonacci, somewhere in Italy some time ago, long time ago, notice that you add two numbers, okay, this to this, and the sum so basically this equals to me. And then this plus this equals to this plus this equals to
4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Huh?
So that's why
the title is like that. And if you see the book cover, she's cut it up in that ratio. Mm-hmm. Every small box, she cut it up again. And this is the design of a clamshell. Not clamshell,
Nautilus.
Nautilus, yes. So you can draw it along the coins, you can get an infinite circle going out, and it's always in this ratio. So that's all the bad time. So now I'll sit down.
Yay!
But halfway I will lose my pictures and then you will laugh at me, okay? one of the things that I was very taken by in Africa are the colours in Africa. It's different, the light and the colour is different from like the equatorial type colour. And when I put on my Ray-Bans, when I put on my Ray-Bans, I realized all the light color changed on me. And I'm very fascinated with colors, so I actually want to do oil painting to mix colors to know how to write about it. But, well, that's not to say I know how to paint. But the first poem I read is called Shades, and it's about colors. Ultraviolet. In the harsh African light, Ray-Bans cut out ultraviolet A and B, turning the wall yellow, amber, without purple. Without purple, there is no amethyst, no indigo, no echinacea putrefacta, no royalty, no rainbow, no violet blue tanzanite. Palette. The early rains break the floodplains out in green spots. Mix ochre with cobalt, some salty rust, with stone blue, a dab of caramel to indigo, the plain canvas becomes a palette, preparing but not ready to paint. Some lemon and beige dry up in the north while dark rose herds kick up coffee brown. And the next few, I can find them, are about sort of the animals.
Don't you love to navigate your own book?
So I say the design is brilliant, it's not mine. The next few are about the first is about the geography, then I'll follow with a few about the animals.
Oh, tectonic shift.
The rift begins up north and south Iran, stretches southwest down Africa, visible from the moon. And so this escarpment falls. If two people drift apart very, very slowly, unnoticed by the human eye, a tectonic shift inching away every year, after two decades, they could be more than 2 feet apart. Monogamy. The ill-monitored golden jackal shifts beneath his mercurial coat on the Ongoro crater floor. Once paired, never leaves his mate. An old couple wanders past, he first, she follows, on the prowl for small bites. The male ostrich with jet black plume sits on the egg at night. His female companion, more like dried mud, takes a shift in the dusty African day. How often do we lie in the dark waiting for our lives to change? Crossing, a zebra young is fuzzy watercolor brown on white. Only later becomes sharp laser jet black and white. Every baby knows his mother's stripes and schemes, a visual DNA and unique ID. When young, we are taught in black and white, our parents' stripes. Only much later to realize the varying shades in the eye of mum's shortcomings and dad's discolorations. Elephant's teeth. An elephant in its lifetime has 6 sets of teeth, each lasting a decade. At 60, no new ones will grow,
allowing it to die slowly. Die of salvation. Here we are, with our crash diets and nutritional fads, not knowing when to let go. That's some work from the African series. Anybody want to leave now? Comment? Any questions?
I think that part of the elephant's teeth, not knowing when to let go, that is so, I don't know how to say, but it's so insightful. For both of the language. Because, yeah, that part speaks to me. Because I have problems letting go of things.
So after 60, they have no more teeth. So basically, an elephant
has
like
no choice.
100 kilograms of leaves and branches a day. Really do it. Everything along the way. Even branches, they would just take it out and just chew. And they need so much because they are so big and they need a lot of energy because they walk around a lot. They eat less, they don't walk. But if they don't, and the teeth will drop off after 10 years and then a new set grows. I mean, a new set is very important. But after 6 sets, they will have no more teeth. So basically, they will die. They cannot eat anything and they will die. And they will wander off to some place where they will die. So there's this idea of the elephant's grave, yeah, or library. So. But they will just, they know, and this is it, they will just go somewhere. They'll be out of the system now. You know? And I thought of this and I thought, gee, you know, with new medicine, we are keeping people alive. We are sometimes keeping people alive way beyond what they want, let alone what we want. Quite a lot of times, we are the ones who don't let go of the people who want to go, and that's why. So, ostensibly it's about the animals, but there's always something I'm thinking about along the way, and sometimes it creeps into the form. The other series at back is much more about the secret, and it's much more Singapore, the scenery, because this is now the Asian egret. I'll read a couple of it. So I will. The eastern egret flies from India to Southeast Asia. To Australia and New Zealand. En route, it stops in a port of call, favouring mangroves, mudflats, estuaries. Here in Singapore, monsoon drains substitute. The mud speckles discolouring the brown male in breeding season. Narrowly escaped the Mad Hatter last century, now retiring as waterway mascots, flourishing in all directions, until some urbane plan. Presuming higher intellect suggests cleaning up Sungai B. Delivery. The usual drop-off of an 8-year-old brings me past the city's key hospital. Its maternity wards caress 12,000-13,000 young ones a year, competitively vying for calendar firstborn. At a routine traffic light, an egret flies overhead, more white than brown. So a female is surmised, delivering yet another genetic parcel today.
Genetic parcel?
Technically it should be the stock, but poetic license.
I love that genetic parcel.
Origami. Square in the monsoon canal, on an ebb post peak hour rains, 9 egrets distributed themselves hither, thither, artistically random. Flecks of white reflected in the gold low tide surface tension, like frail origami boats. Dark in the deep blue sky, a silver cloud sliver echoed like the white of the sailboat the river's eye drifting home. Shiny lyrics in the Chinese song of old. And finally, the last one, home. Same white wings, same yellow tint, same long beak, same monsoon drain. The northern cold to the southern warm. Why go so far only to double back? Why not let the rest of us stay midway in tropical muck at home? And that's the home series. So they're reading all, you will not buy the book. So that's why I did not read.
Maybe I will. Maybe I also go a little bit to explain why. Because sometimes people do ask me, and I've been scolded a couple of times by readers, why do you make the books so difficult to read? You know, of course there are some reasons for that. The funny one being that then you got to buy two books. You tie one up, then you still have the other one. Look at it, you know? Yeah. But the real reason actually why I thought that this was worth investing in, you know, to make the book this way, is because the subject matter and the thoughts that drove Madeleine's writing is very well represented. It's very well represented in the form of the book itself. Okay, I mean, you look at this Wildebeest, you look at the egrets and all that, how do they know the way? All the way up to Serengeti and back down again, right? You can't say it's instinct. I mean, sometimes even human beings, when you use a GPS system, you get lost. Right? But how does the bird, how does the wildebeest know that this way, you know? And so it looks like such a simple thing, go north, come south, you know, and go one circle. But yet at the same time, you look into it a little more, there's a lot of depth in there. And until today, I don't think many people will be able to say for sure 100% why they understand how this wildebeest, or how the migration things happen. They can only look at the trends, that's all, right? And in the same way, poetry, to me, poetry, poems, and some of the poems that Madeleine has written, at least from my point of view, it's like that, you know, it looks simple, but yet if you sort of let it sink in and you think about it a bit more, there's a lot of insights, or there's a lot of things that you can extrapolate from that, you know, and that's part of the beauty of poetry, because it speaks to different people in different ways, from your life experiences. Yeah, so I said it's worth it. There are just like, I don't know, how many poems? 13 and 8, yeah. 21 poems, yeah. And it's a very thin book, you know. But by the time you figure out how to navigate it, I think you'll feel like it's a full book. And look at the things, yeah. So I think this is really a piece of art. It's not just poetry, but also art in physical form. And I would encourage readers to actually buy the book, you know, and try to figure out how this thing works, how the turn and the twist work, you know. And who knows, maybe you might solve the mystery of migration. I don't know. Yeah. Okay, But apart from this book, of course, Madeleine has also written, I told you she has got 6 collections of poetry to her name, you know. I don't know if you want to share something. Some favorite
that you made at this point. Yes, I wanted to. I mean, I'm happy to take questions about the world before I carry on.
The golden question, writing advice.
Okay, we'll put a pin in that one. Yeah, I hate that expression. Put a pin in it. I know you use it.
Yeah, I'm just kidding. You are obviously well balanced. That's a terrible way to put it. You're good in math, you're good in literature. So, if I were to give you a tough choice, you had to choose between your investment math and not taking money, not taking externals,
natural. What is natural, right? Because the questions are about, well, I mean, it describes what is speed, what on a lower level, what is speed, what is the area underneath the curve, because it's actually quite important, and that's why you say integration, yes. So, you know, and it's not made up, it's made to describe something, so the logic starts and ends in itself, it's whole. And that's beautiful for me. Totally balanced. And when I'm not gonna answer directly, but when I write, I mean I don't okay, when I teach, people, the students will put a hand and say, what is your inspiration? Which I never know how to answer. Who can answer this question? I mean
nature.
Yes, so I am amazed and I'm in awe of the whole migration. But what moved me beyond taking picture, which I also love, to put down a thought that is not just about going around or something like that, but there is something more, and I think there must be something more, otherwise I can take picture, I can paint. But there is something more, there's a bigger meaning, and sometimes it occurs to me bits of a bigger arc or a bigger meaning. And in this case, it was about sort of, you know, wandering and coming home. Not just physically, but sometimes you wander in your thoughts and you have to return to what's real, what's true.
Object.
You can get distracted, but you have to come back to some place where you are comfortable and safe and know that is true, that everything is constant in that space. And you always return to this, but it doesn't have to be a physical space. You know, so if you're religious, you'll find the answers there. If you're a musical, you'll find something in the music. And for me, the meaning of poetry and how it's not just a single-pointed meaning, it has a lot for me, the words, the different layers. So it's very
dense. Sorry.
It's very, I want to say, it's very layered. Mm-hmm. And that works for me. You know, so maths is not just squiggles, because it describes something. Maths is layered, so you have to think about it.
If you talk to the mathematicians, they say that the formulas are elegant. They even go elegant.
It's beautiful. They're beautiful.
Yes. Yeah. I've never seen beauty.
This is because we all taught maths wrongly, but no, seriously, we are told to do sums the whole time.
Yeah,
it's really that ugly, okay?
I think that's boring. I think that's boring.
So I see a lot of elegance and beauty and lessons and irony in places and in things. So nothing inspires me in that sense. I have no imagination. I cannot write you a novel that I don't know what happens after scene one. That would be a play, right? What happens after chapter one? I often cannot even think of names for the characters. But I can observe and I can write. And I can think about what is it I'm observing. And I can write a couple of layers into it.
Yeah.
So that's my thing. Mm-hmm. And that's why my thesis is you can all write about anything. You can write poetry about anything. At all is around you. Anything. You don't have to go to Switzerland or Iceland or Alaska or Africa. No need. There's so much in Singapore to write. All my nature pieces are actually very local, in a sense. It's all written from walks here. And it's almost, I mean, how to be eco-poet in Singapore when it's so urban? Although I will have to say right now, I didn't call myself eco-poet, some critic did, and got stuck. But I do write about earthworms, I do write about fungus, I do write about yucky things. But it's not really about the three leaves that I saw. It's about something. And it's about what strikes me when I see these things and I keep thinking, and that's why I walk. Because we need time, and I think we don't take time, all of us. 3 minutes. I'm not showing off, but this is, I'm just saying, when it occurs, you just write, okay? I was sitting in Starbucks. Very good, very good. I looked up and I saw this table, and I wrote it down. And I wrote it down, seemingly like a description of a part of it. But at the end of it, there was a point, and the point occurred to me sort of halfway through the third couplet. And let me see if you can get it from my right in the old book.
Sure.
Coffee. 0404. Oh, not so good number. Coffee. It written 8th January 2004. That's really old. Coffee. Starbucks Cafe Society. Caffeine-induced sobriety. He pouring 2% dairy. She pouring over daily. Babies with foamies, fluttering mummies. Brain cells not working, state of sleepwalking. Raggy shirt guy amuses, curses at today's news. The girls sit in clumps, discussing their latest poems. The college boy bowls with furrowed brow, reads physics text, tapping latest tracks. Wireless connection drops. Writer pauses at tabletop. So, on one level, I'm just like, this person. On another level,
what is it regarding? Coffee?
And basically at the end, as the poem ends, when I said up the whole music, it stopped everything. And it was very jarring. And that's all, I mean, you know, so that was his interpretation. I mean, it was pretty darn close to what I wanted to say.
Yeah, if we want to see that interpretation on the screen, how do we get it? Is it in the VCD?
We don't have it. I think it may be on YouTube.
Okay.
But it is in the library.
I'm sure it's
as a video.
It's a video, right?
What's the name of it?
The whole series is called 1,000 Words. Oh, because the picture is worth looking around. I don't know. But they had six writers. Anyway, so all I'm trying to say is, there's so much around you, there's so much on the train, there's so much. If you take off your earphones and stop staring at your phone, you know.
And that also got me.
And there's lots of stuff that you can use for that.
As a noisy student.
I'm supposed to be a bit kippo lah, isn't it? And you must observe, I think, you know, that's why. I don't know, I mean, people ask me how can you write a piece about a bracket fungus?
Yeah.
Yeah, but, you know.
Could you read us a fungus plot?
It's the multi one. It's the multi piece. Things in nature are just triggers, if you would. And things when you go on holiday and see things when you go traveling. That just triggers for kind of slightly
reflection.
More pensive thoughts, perhaps. Reflection. I'm the only one about cows. About traveling, I've written, obviously this kind of travel poem, I've written five liners, one five line poem about the history of England, really. Because when I finished the fifth line, I thought, okay, it's done. It's done. I mean, there was no more. I can go on, but I really did, but I did not. This is the biggest writing. Sorry, it's white, but it's actually this color. This book is called Egret, which is not bird, but it's French for Greek letter Y. It also is a play on the French way of saying a Greek place. And this was written after a 14-day trip in Greece. And it's different from that book because there were a few of us there, and two of us wrote poetry secretly. So we went to the same places every day, we looked at the same thing. Some of us wrote prose, and some of us wrote poetry. And I came home, this is the third book, so this was the second book. And my publisher said, this book is a bit thin, huh? You must give me a few more poetry. He doesn't talk like that. Give me some more. And I said, oh, I don't have any more like really decent ones, so I will go to Greece in April and I'll come back.
Do you think your publisher, when they said that was like torturing you?
No. So, and when I came back, I had 24.
Wow.
So I had a series of 2,000 poems. And I showed it to him and I liked it. And unbeknownst to me, another person who had gone on a trip had a collection of 12. Mm-hmm. And he was publishing, it's Eleanor Wong, right? So he was publishing Eleanor's plays, this was Roots. And they were talking about something, blah, 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 and then she said, oh, I also have 12. And then he looked at the 36, 24 plus 12, and he decided that was a book. And so this is one book. One travel, one journey rather, written by two people, so it's like totally another scale and completely accidental. And there are the five liners. And later, I used to write just one poem each time, and later I found that I was writing multi-part poems about a journey. And of course, this is the biggest multi-part poem I can tell you. That one is the 13th part. The first poem that I did like that was in Paris, where it was a 7-part poem. It's one of my favorites. I used to write small poems, and this was like a big one time. It's a breakthrough kind of writing. And it's not about Eiffel Tower and eating clay. It's not
touristy.
And it was about genius and how it cannot be understood. So it was about Saint Denis, the saint. Was martyred. It was about the art exhibition that had to do with Matisse and Van Gogh. It was about Van Gogh shooting himself in the ear, or cutting his ear and then shooting himself. Not on the same day. It was about, then from genius I moved to misunderstood genius, which was at the tail end of Van Gogh. It went to Virginia Woolf and how she could not understand the genius that was in her head, so it became like insanity to her. And then she had to drown. She basically killed herself, yes. Right, by stepping the river. Mm-hmm. And about dead people's books, which are being sold on the side of the Seine. I don't know if you've been to Paris, but all these little old bookstores that's in the shack and open up on weekends to sell these old books, and we don't know who the hell wrote them, and even cannot read French so well. So And where all these thoughts are going, you see? So ostensibly it's about Notre Dame, but actually it's not that. So I don't know when that occurs and how the taking notes of daylight. So I broke time down,
counting sacred cows. Barely out of the capital, the cows come on the highway. A dead brown cow on the edge, the fast lane, how now? Under the pancut flyover cottage shop, by a dirt strip with bike parts shops, a loud pushy seller squats toothfully, discussing with a friend perhaps how many pasties he needs to sell to accumulate a decent dowry. In front, in a jam, a young buffalo with dewy eyes is stuck on a truck as vehicles come wrong way at us. Even sacred cows are stood up. And it goes on. It was all about the cows I saw. The cow.
Chickens.
And that's five parts. It ends with a one part small stanza because it kind of had to do with the Dalai Lama that I went to listen to. But anyways, long story. But that's sort of how it started. So there's plenty. I urge you to look around for inspiration and triggers. And those who don't necessarily want to write what they see, I think there's a lot to think about if you just look around you.